we together join together to resist anything that would hinder your work in this place. And we resist it now in the name of Jesus, but we welcome you to come and do whatever you have planned for us this day. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And I'm going to invite Claire and Emmanuel to come and lead us in our worship together. Thank you.
Deserves it. Hallelujah. And we all like worshiping God in our prayer rooms, I believe. And both of us with Emmanuel, we love praising God since we were little. And it's a special beauty to praise God all together when we are gathered in a prayer place, you know, the place where God is. And He's waiting for us. We are just coming to Him with our open hearts. And Lord, we want to praise and give you thanks for what you've done in our lives and this week, God. And we want to praise your glorious name. Amen. Praise is rising. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. This place, and we believe you are here. Hallelujah. And you are the Almighty God, and we praise the Most High God. Hallelujah. Water you turn, water you turn into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, no one like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no we can say that my God is greater than any problems they face. My God is stronger than any enemies that wants to fight me. God, you are the great one. And we love you, Lord. And in the next song, we want to say, I love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my mind. I love you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. As your children, we love you. As your bride, we love you. As your church. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. For your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. Let's sing again. I love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord. For your mercy never fails me. Oh, my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Father, we thank you for every life here that can say, Lord, you have been faithful. Everyone in whom your Holy Spirit is dwelling and working, we thank you. Father, we thank you that that promise of your faithfulness is for us all. As we reach out to you in the storms of life, in the hard times, in the wilderness, when we just can't understand why a thing might be. But Lord, we reach out to you and we say, God, we put our trust in you at all times. Father, I thank you that with the songwriter, I personally can say, Lord, that you have been faithful. And that I stand here today, Lord, not because of my performance or anything else, but Lord, because of your faithfulness and your very, very, very great mercy. And I thank you. And I thank you. Amen. Please do sit down. Thank you so much. Brilliant. So as we move on and give thanks to God and are here, we come to a moment where we can say sorry to God. And I spoke last week of the cycles of that God has built into creation, of the sun rising in the morning and setting at the night, so that we can have a new start. And every time we come and acknowledge Jesus as Lord and we thank him for the blood that he shed on the cross, we know that we can come to him and avail ourselves of all the benefits of the cross, it says in the communion service. We might receive all the benefits of the cross. And so we load these words, these familiar words, with our own story of this last week and maybe some big things that you want to just present to the Lord. And we say together these words of confession. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. So it's by faith and with hearts full of thanks that we receive the power of his mercy. May the God of love and power forgive you, forgive us all, and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. So we acknowledge that Jesus is the one who paid the price for peace in our hearts. He paid the price with his life. And that's why we refer to his blood covering us. Because his blood is significant and it signifies the life. The flowing of blood is life. And he poured his out so that it might cover us. And that blood is the most powerful agent in the universe to protect us from all that is evil and all that is wicked and the lies of the enemy. He would whisper into your ear. We plead the blood of Christ to come and protect us. And it's enough because it is higher and more powerful than any other force or any other agent in the world. It cuts through, it sets us free, breaks chains, and makes a way. So Jesus is the Prince of Peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. So let's just acknowledge one another here and those who are joining us online and just stand and greet. We can shake hands now, which is wonderful, but let's just see if you see somebody just next to each and so on. That'd be great. Thank you. So I don't know if This is now the time where I open up the service for you to share things which will be an encouragement. If you would like to share, I know that there have been some encouragements this week, but it's up to you whether you share them, and that's very good. So let's just pray. Holy Spirit, will you come, inspire us as your people, that if you have something that you would have any particular person say, Lord, I pray that your Spirit would just nudge and prompt those of us to speak on your behalf. Come, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. And if you'd like to, please do raise a hand and I'll be looking for that. Thank you. Do you want to come forward? Come right forward. Can I introduce Samuel to you? Some of you know him because he was helping with the thank you tea in the Timothy room. Come. Samuel, we welcome you. Just 2 weeks ago, we met Samuel in the Village Cafe. Great place to meet people. But usually, people stick to their own tables and they don't necessarily kind of mingle in the Village Cafe. But I have a wife who doesn't stick to that rule, and just felt prompted by God to go over to a lonely figure in the corner of the cafe, and it was Samuel. And Claire went over and overcame a sort of, they're just going to tell me you're talking to everybody again. And you overcame that, Claire, to go and speak to Samuel. And it's turned out to be an extremely significant conversation. Samuel, would you like to just say hello?
Yes,
take the microphone.
Thank you.
I have a microphone, so that's your one. Speak into it.
Thank you very much.
So where are you from, Samuel? Where are you from, Samuel?
My name is Samuel. I'm from Kenya.
And where in Kenya?
In Nairobi.
So what have you been doing over here, Samuel?
I've been working as a chef.
A chef?
Yeah, as a sous chef, yeah.
And you were working up the road, weren't you?
Yeah. I was working down there at the Punch Bowl Hotel.
At the Punch Bowl Hotel.
Yeah.
And then the job came to an end,
yeah.
And you were in the cafe feeling pretty low, weren't you?
Yeah, I was feeling as if I have reached to an end. But
What on earth you're doing in this country on your own with nothing and nowhere to go.
Yes.
And you were losing your accommodation.
Yes,
correct. Right. So, we have prayed for Samuel. And I think you've got some good news, haven't you? Would you like to share the good news?
Yes, please.
Carry on.
Thank you very much. Yeah, first and foremost, I want to thank God for this golden opportunity to be here. Thanks for having me. Also, I want to extend also my love to you and your family.
Thank you.
I don't take this for granted. I believe the anointing upon your life is what has made me to be who I am this morning, because God has been using you, and I have seen God through you.
Praise the Lord.
So, when I lost my job 2 weeks ago, I was wondering, and I came down there to that village cafe. I was just seated there, and I was like, God, do what you can only do. So when I was coming down from the roadside, I told God, I thank you because my job has ended, and I thank you for the new job that is coming. So I was prepared that it has ended, but I knew it is not the end for God. It was a new chapter and a new beginning. How lovely to be identified to such a father who is caring and who is always there for you. Even in the middle of crisis, he is still with you.
Amen.
Deep in the fire, he is still with you.
Praise
when
Lord.
You go down, he is still with you. I thank God for this.
What happened next?
What happened next? I've been applying for jobs, going for interviews, different hotels. But finally, it was 2 days ago. 3 days ago, I got an invitation to go for another interview down in Clitheroe,
yes.
Yeah, in Lancashire.
Lancashire.
Yeah. So when I went there, miraculously, by the grace of God, I want to say it's not because of my skills. It's not because of being so good. But I did the trials and the interviews. But something I want to tell you is that God can choose any vessel and God can use anybody in this life. God is not limited in resources and in anything. After doing the trial, I was actually supposed to do trial for 2 days. But after doing the trial, cooking and doing all the preparations, doing marination and all that, the head chef came to me and said, you know what, you don't have to do any other interview for tomorrow, because we've been having previously some chefs coming in for trial, but you are the best among the chefs who have been coming. And what you have done, we have not seen any other chef doing. So I got the job, and amazingly, the place and the hotel and the entity and the business is owned by the royal family. The king.
It belongs to the Duchy of Lancaster, which of course is the king. And so it belongs to the king. So you never know, he may be cooking for the King Charles in time to come.
Yeah.
We thank God for this. So let's just thank the Lord. Heavenly Father, we pray for Samuel. We thank you, Lord, that your hand is upon his life. Father, we thank you for this blessing and this quick turnaround. And Father, we honor him and we for his faith. And we thank you, Lord God, and we pray that your blessing would blow after him and his family back in Nairobi. And we pray, Father God, that you would bless this man and raise him up to do all those things that you would have him do in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Wonderful. Wonderful. Praise the Lord. God is at work. Anybody else would like to share anything? Thank you.
Right, I'm not sure I'm going to manage to get all these words out, so Hilary or Anne, you might need to help me a little bit. Friday lunchtime, I'm at work, stood in reception, and I heard breaking glass. Well, it was a car driving through the side of the building. So I have a great big thank you for I'm still alive, nobody was seriously injured, and what could have been an absolute disaster was as okay as a car inside your building can ever be.
Wow.
So thank you.
Amen. Father, amen. Thank you. Anybody else? As I just pray. But Heavenly Father, we thank you for your mercy and your protection for Alice, Lord, and we for all of those, and for the driver as well. And we pray, Lord God, for your mercy upon this place, Lord, that we would have protection in this village by your grace. In Jesus' name. Amen. Anybody else? Just one quick. Yes, thank you.
Hello again. So as you know, we went to Ukraine and we came back a couple of weeks ago, 1 week ago actually. As we said, that God is so faithful and he protects us all and he looks after us all. And while we were there for 3 weeks, God was so faithful to us. He gave us absolute peace and protection. And even though we had a couple of really dangerous days, I think Emmanuel experienced three dangerous days. Me, I experienced just two. But still, it was very loud. It was just bits of rockets falling on the buildings around. But God was so faithful. He gave us absolute peace, and he kept us safe, all of us. We were together one day in my sister's place with my mom and Emmanuel and Martha, and we were praying at night, at the end of the day, we were praying and saying, God, if you allow us to leave tomorrow, we want to live for you, and we just want to carry on doing what you are calling us to do. And we prayed and we slept in peace, but we woke up because of this, you know, loud noises, and the building was shaking, and we started messaging our friends, how are you doing, and all that stuff. But we felt, all of us, we felt absolute peace. And that was incredible, just because, you know, the world around and people are so scary and they are in the chaos. God is faithful. God is our peace. So he gave us that peace. So I just praise God. And also, I went to Ukrainian camp, winter camp, so we managed to do it for 5 days or 6 days with our kids. Some of them, they had their parents fighting in the war, and they came over to that camp. And at that day, a very dangerous day in Kyiv, we were in the west of Ukraine, and we didn't experience that danger. And we all were just standing on our knees, you know, and you see, like, those kids, they were, like, 6, 7 years, some of them, 13, 15, and so on. And they were praying for peace for Ukraine. And it was such a lovely moment when you saw these kids are praying and worshiping God, asking God for mercy. And at the end of the day, the sirens went, they stopped, and every one of our families, they were safe. And we were all together, we praising God for his faithfulness. And those kids, they are, even though they live in dangerous moments and during the war, but they see God's hand and they see God's miracles. So that's great. Thank you.
Thank you. And of course, there, the miracle is peace in their heart when so many are panicking. So Lord, we bless those children, and thank you, Lord, for this testimony of your grace. Come, Lord Jesus, upon us all, and teach us your peace deep down within our hearts, even when things are tough and difficult and chaotic and troubling. Teach us your peace, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all. Wonderful. We're going now to have our readings, and and then we'll move on to the talk. Thank you. Thank you. Up there, please. Yeah, that'd be great. Thanks, Anna.
This reading is taken from the book of Revelation, chapter 19, beginning at verse 6. Then I heard what sounded like a great multitude, like the roar of rushing waters and like sound peals of thunder, shouting, "Hallelujah, for our Lord God Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad to give him glory. For the wedding of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. Fine linen, bright and clean, was given her to wear." Then the angel said to me, "Write this: blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb." And he added, "These are the true words of God." At this, I fell at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, "Don't do that. I am a fellow servant with you and with your brothers and sisters who hold to the ceremony of Jesus. Worship God. For it is the spirit of prophecy who bears testimony to Jesus." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The second reading is taken from John's Gospel, chapter 2, beginning at the first verse. On a third day, a wedding took place in Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Dear woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My time has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby stood 6 stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine, after the guests have had too much to drink. but you have saved the best till now. This, for the first of his miraculous signs, Jesus performed at Cana in Galilee. He thus revealed his glory, and his disciples put their faith in him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for these amazing readings, one from Revelation and one from the Gospel of John. And we thank you, Lord, that you speak to us through your word to build us up and to encourage us in your plans and how we should live today. And so we ask, Lord, by the power of your Spirit, that you would come and reveal to us those things that you would teach us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so as we look at these two readings, I'm not going to do everything about all of them, that would take all day, but the point is that we have a theme. First of all, this is Epiphany, and Epiphany started with the three kings and the revelation to Gentile leaders and wise men, the glory of Jesus, that he was the king, revealed to Gentiles. So this is the first time that we see this outreach beyond to the Magi coming and the three kings. And of course, they honor Jesus with that revelation of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And so what we see is an honoring relationship, but also a breaking of a boundary. Because the boundary, of course, historically for the Jews was that they were the chosen people. It was separate. They were kind of separated for God, and the Gentiles were all the rest. And so now what we see is this boundary being opened up. In another talk, we talked from Ephesians about the mystery of Christ. And Paul teaches us that the mystery of Christ is that all the promises and the wealth and the blessings of the Jews would now, through faith in the cross, through the work of Jesus on the cross, through the power of the blood, which I mentioned earlier in the service, through the power of the blood, we could come in and receive all of those. That's amazing. That is huge. And for us to miss that in our lives is a great loss, because then we can see. And really what that is that's the sewing up of why the scriptures in the Old Testament are so important to us. Because those promises reveal the character of God towards his people, and we are his people. In John chapter 1, it says that his own received him not. John chapter 1, the Christmas reading, his own received him not, but to those who received him gave he power to become the children of God, which we are when we receive him. Now, last week we talked about the hallmark upon the church, which is Jesus. The works associated with the kingdom of God have that hallmark, and it's that we are called to look like Jesus. That was one of the themes that came out from last week. So we have this Revelation 19 passage, which tells us that the church is the bride of Christ. And the bride of Christ is given clothes of fine linen. A little thing goes off in my mind, of course, is that the priests in the temple, their undergarments were made of pure fine linen. And their undergarments were symbolic of cleanliness on the inside, and that no sweat, no effort would impact the outer garments that they wore. So it wasn't coming from themselves, if you like. There's some imagery there which needs to be unpicked, but it's like a priestly thing, this white linen. But then it says that the white linen represents, let me just get it, the white linen, the fine linen, stands for the righteous acts of God's holy people. So this is Revelations 19. If you've got a Bible in your things, it would be good to have a look at that. But it says that the fine linen, bright and clean, was given her to wear. Fine linen stands for the righteous acts of God's holy people. And one of the themes that's coming out is that God is calling us to be holy. Now, how do we do that? How do I be more holy? And I want to say that actually I can't be any more holy than the next person out of my own effort and the gritting of my teeth. I'll try hard, just try harder. This is what the Pharisees did, and that was their error, which is they were trying to be good enough so that one day when we're all perfect and we do it right, which is why their detail on their focus on the law, if we can just do it right for one day, the Messiah will come back. That way, they missed it. So what is holiness then? Holiness has to do with our attitudes, has to do with our inner life. Holiness then, according to all the revelation really around this, is it has to be our willingness and our yieldedness to allow the Holy Spirit, the presence of God himself, the Holy Spirit, to be the ruling authority and the ruling means. So Jesus is on the throne of our lives, and we are yielded enough to allow the Pentecostal fire of the Holy Spirit to come, because that was the only thing that changed Peter from being a timid, frightened, failed, you know, denier of Christ, terrified, having got it wrong, completely broken confidence, that there was a coming of the Holy Spirit and the forgiving of Jesus, of course, go and feed my sheep, if you remember at the beach. He said, and then he allowed the Holy Spirit to come. And it was the free capacity that the apostles and the disciples had to allow the Holy Spirit. So it's letting the Holy Spirit come through us. It's breathing his Holy Spirit into us. So that's about holiness. And that's about being holy and what that means. God is calling us to holiness. And yes, there is a sense in which the greater capacity that we have to let God demonstrate himself through us, the more capacity we have, then the greater of the flow and the less we will get in the way of what God wants to do. I find myself getting in the way. That's the problem. Sin is when I choose myself, my own comforts, my own ways, and I reject God's ways. So holiness is also about God, his sanctifying work in us. So he saves us through the blood. Now that's the first step. We have to come and do what Jesus says and repent, which is to turn away from myself and turn to him. And then the next step is to step into believing. Repent and believe, he said so many times. Repent and believe. So our believing is walking in who he is, what he says, and trusting what he is wanting for us. So actually what we've got here is a holiness which comes out of him working in us, but also a holiness, a sanctifying work. And here it's quite helpful to think of gold in jewelry. I know we've talked about hallmarks. Well, a piece of jewelry can only get a hallmark when it's been tested for its purity. And so what happens is there's a stone which they get. There are various ways of assaying, testing metal. One of them is by fire, seeing how much pure metal there is. Another one is by acid test. So different concentrations of acid will be put on gold, because there are certain acids, one acid which will melt, will dissolve gold. So you can tell through that. And then there's another one which is about blasting x-rays at a lump of gold and seeing how much comes through, because it's about testing the purity. And actually, in other words, testing the purity is part of the work of sanctification. It's like God is working on us to purify us more and more, so that there's less of me and there's more of him, week by week. And this is the testing of life. Sometimes things are tough. We've just had Samuel's testimony that he came to the sort of very end. What was his reaction? He said, "I thank you, Lord, that you have a promise for my life and that you have another job for me." I don't want to oversimplify for everybody. There was a time where I had no job for a whole year. A whole year. That was a tough time. But that was because that was God's purpose and plan for my life, to learn how to wait and trust him. Okay? So it's not a simple matter of, oh, I'll have a bit of what Samuel's got. It's about learning to trust God and praise him when it's tough. Okay. So there's this process of going on. And then I want to look at the marriage in Cana. And I just take a few little lessons from it. Now, I'm hoping and I'm thinking that you've probably heard that story a few times. I say it, I refer to it every single time I do a wedding, saying that Jesus was invited to a wedding and look what happened. And aren't weddings a lovely thing? So that's part of what I do. But actually what we see is a number of things in here. And I just want to draw two or three out and then ask us a question. So one of the things was that Mary was trying to gee Jesus up and say, "Come on, do something. They're embarrassed. There's no wine. What are they going to do? Do something." Now, remember that Mary had been pondering all the promises of God right from his birth, and she knew who he was. I said, "Come on." And he said, "Leave me, because my time has not yet come." Well, how does that work with him then going and doing it? Well, the only thing I can take out of that is that it's very important that we know that Mary didn't manipulate Jesus. It's very important that we don't manipulate God for a miracle. All right, we don't. That's why that's there. Because if it had worked, then we would have taken that strategy for trying getting our own way. No, but his time was in fact come. So what we see is that Mary says to them, "Do what he says." Obedience is absolutely at the heart of the kingdom of God and the works of the kingdom that we want to do. We want revival. We want this place absolutely packed. We want to see people's lives turned around and restored. We want the miracle of water into wine in our hearts. Our water becoming the wine and the precious, mature refreshment for others. So do what he says, and then Jesus tells them what to do. Go and fill the water jars. And what do? They're not mean. They don't just, I'll fill them. They fill the water jars to the brim. Now, there's just another connection here, which is that we are earthen vessels. Paul talks about us being, he puts his treasure in earthen vessels. Isn't that nice? So actually our response is abundance, generosity, overflowing when we respond to the words of Jesus. Let us go the whole hog, all right? Let's go the full way. My iPad's died. So let's go the whole way with what God is calling us to do. Forgive me, I'm just going to use this. So actually what this then says is that they filled it up to the brim, and then Jesus says, "Go and pour out from these and take it." Now this was a risk. If they'd just taken water from the hand-washing purification jars to the head of the feast, that was a risky thing to do. But actually, God vindicated in that moment. Now, where did the miracle happen? I believe the miracle happened in the pouring out, in the obedience, and in the risk-taking of their obedience. Isn't that a lovely thing? God is working in us. So, and the vindication comes that it's like kind of God has kind of turned human nature upside down. He gives us the best at the end. And there's something prophetic for us in that we are waiting for the best. The best is yet to come. The best is yet to come for us here at St. Luke's in Grayshott. The best is yet to come. The revival that we pray for is coming, and it's going to be far greater and far better than we can think. So, how do we use this today? Well, I just want to just start the ball rolling without going into too much detail. I want to start the ball rolling by saying, God is calling us to work like Jesus did. The hallmark of the church is that we begin to look like Jesus and do the works that he did. So what does this mean for us? Well, I believe that this means that if you are invited to an event, it might be a wedding, it might be a party, it might be a dinner thing, that we go into it with a willingness to be used by God, an openness. So, quite often I will say to myself and I will say to God, right, Lord, who do you want me to speak to? Because I would far rather have one conversation with one person that really makes a difference to their lives. That's not I want to be heavy with everybody, please understand, than an entire event of small talk where we've gone absolutely nowhere with anybody. Because it may be that there is somebody there that God wants to touch with a miracle. With a miracle. Because of you. So I just want to say that it might be that your availability to God, Samuel said this actually, he said, it's not how good we are, but it's how open we are to the Lord. And it's when God knits hearts together and makes friendships beautifully by his Spirit that amazing things happen. And we see that. And I just want to mention one thing, which was that John Stott, a very famous preacher from the last century, he's dead now, but it was a massive influence. He used to talk about something called double listening. I don't know if you've heard that, but basically what it means is that you are giving your full attention to the person that you're speaking to. You're really listening and hearing them, but you're also listening to the Word of God, the Scriptures, and you're listening to the prompting of the Holy Spirit. So you're listening in the light of what God might be using you to say. So it's a double listening thing. And in that, we are all available to be prophets for God. That it might be that you actually say, well, let me pray for you. And it may be that God will vindicate your prayer with an amazing turnaround in somebody's life. You know, I know that there are people here who've had incredible turnarounds in their life. And you know who you are. You know, God has done amazing things. And I'm going to conclude with this. But let us be those who go to these things ready and available and willing to be used by God. It might be that it's just a simple, I want you to invite them to the next week's service. I want you to just listen to their story. I just want you to say this to them. Do what he says. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for abundance. We thank you for obedience, and we thank you for availability. And we pray, Lord God, that we might all grow in all of those things, in our generosity of spirit, in our availability to you, and our obedience to your word. Open our ears that we may hear what you are saying. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Now Hillary is going to come and we're going to pray for the world. Thank you so much.
So as we come to this point in our service, do we dare to believe that our prayers can make a difference? In approaching a God whose solutions may be beyond our wildest hopes and dreams, anything, anything becomes possible. So now we raise those areas where conflict, violence, and war have destabilized, devastated, and destroyed lives, homes, and livelihoods. Ukraine, Palestine, Israel, Pakistan, Syria, Iraq, Yemen, Somalia. We bring before you the leaders of the world. We dare to believe that you can frustrate ambition. You can change hearts and minds and raise up peacemakers. Wild God, we ask for peace. We ask for protection for the innocent and the vulnerable. And we ask for hope for the future. We raise the problems of climate change to the wild creator of our world, to the one who planned and designed life, the architect of our world's geography. We ask you for help. Wild creator, change our hearts and minds. Help us to care unreservedly, not selectively, freely, not conditionally, quietly, not ostentatiously, generously, not grudgingly. We raise the church worldwide to you and ask your wild spirit to unite and heal division so that the church, your bride, speaks out with power and authority. And in our own church, in this week of Christian unity, help us to recognize that without unity in this place, your work here is compromised. Help us to embrace everyone linked to this church and its community in one family, so that everyone will know a sense of belonging, feel valued, useful, and loved here at St. Luke's. You are a God who loves surprisingly, wildly, unconditionally, and forever. We bring to you those who are hurt, those who need to feel the touch of your love today, worldwide, nationally, locally, here. We especially raise to you those families who are mourning the loss of loved ones. And we raise to you our village school as it strives to support two families who've lost a parent in the last 7 weeks. We raise to you those suffering from failing health or pain, for those facing loss of independence, for those whose families are divided for whatever reason, for those finding it hard to make ends meet. You are a God of wild hope. We believe that our prayers are brought to your throne and that they will join with the millions of prayers of the faithful around the world. keep us open to your answers. Keep us attentive to all that you want to do for us and all that you want us to do for you. Keep us alert to the needs of others. Keep us ready to see water turned into wine. In the name of your Son, our Saviour, our Redeemer, and our friend. Amen.
Thank you. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are indeed the one who turns our ordinary into extraordinary when Jesus is present. So we continue with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. So as we come to our final song, we give thanks for this time together as we have been part of that process of remembering the heavenly, which comes from the book of Revelation. And we understand that image and we bring it together with our ordinary life. And we listen to God and we bring the two together, and his glory will be revealed, just as Hilary has really prayed, that we are prepared to take the risk on you, O Lord our God. Amen. Thank you. So we're going to stand and we're going to sing our final song, during which there will be a collection as an offering, as a part of our worship, as we give, and our many of you give electronically, of course, that's fine, it's an opportunity as part of our worship here. So thank you. You can do that again, Jim. We're going to sing Water and You Turn Into Wine Again with energy.
Into the darkness you shine.
So, Father, as we thank you for your word which gives hope, your word which speaks of a greater reality than that which we see, that is limited by time and space. And so we say, God, would you do all that you desire to do in us and through us, and that your power will be revealed. And as Hillary prayed, do we dare to believe that our prayers here in Grayshott, might make a difference to break the power of darkness and to shatter the control over people's lives, that they might be set free and liberated to live with you and in your love, and to know your grace and freedom from sins and problems and pain and trauma of the past, and come into life with you. So we pray, Lord, for your blessings. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and our minds in that knowledge that you love us as Father, and of your Son Jesus, who died, was buried, was raised, and is now seated on the throne, and of all that work that he has done for us. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us and remain with us all, and all those for whom we have been praying, and all of those who have shared testimony, and those who've been touched by your Spirit and your word in our hearts today, that your blessing would go with us, and that we would be a blessing to those that we see and meet, and that you'd use each one of us for the building of your kingdom. Amen. At the end of communions, we usually say this, but I'm going to say it this time. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen. Thank you. Now, after this, there is tea and coffee in the church rooms. Sheila has tickets for the Winter Warmer event, which is on the 10th of February. So it's coming up quite soon, which will be in the Timothy room in the church hall. And so what we've got is a few things. Don't forget the thing at the village hall, which is the health hub that's been initiated by the surgery. But thank you all for coming today, and bless you.